going to talk about A Year in the Rain, which is the name of our debut, A Year Since the Rain, sorry, A Year Since the Rain, which is our novel by our guest speaker today, Shane Wilson. Shane is a former instructor here. How many of you remember Shane? Yay, look at all those hands. And parents, you should raise your hand because you do remember your son, right?
How many of you hired Shane to be an instructor?
Yay! I'm going to read the bio from the back of Shane's book, but I'll do it in an instructive and informative manner. And we're not going to hold the first part against him. Born in Alabama and raised in Georgia, Shane Wilson is a child of the southeastern United States, where he feels simultaneously at home and out of place. How many of you can relate? He graduated from Valdosta State University in South Georgia with a master's in English. Everyone who has an English degree say yay! Yay! That was pretty good. He taught college English in Georgia for 4 years before following love in North Carolina in 2013. We all say aww.
Aww.
No matter the temperature outside, there is always an iced coffee in his hand when he walks into class in the mornings. He tends to chase the day with a whiskey. A rerun of The Office. Shane has published poetry in Tethered by Letters and the Stonepile Writers Anthology, Volume 3. He currently is at work on a new novel, as well as a collection of short stories based on the mythos of and set in the same town as A Year Since the Rain. A Year Since the Rain is published by Snow Leopard Publishing, if I can get that out. And we are so excited to have our very own, even though he's moved to North Carolina, we're still there claiming him here in Georgia, our very own Shane Wilson.
What's the impetus for singing?
A release?
Well, it's because that new Iggy Azalea track dropped and we just got to get it out, you know? Just kidding. Literally no person has ever said that new Iggy Azalea track just dropped and I had to get it out. You know, that is not a thing people say. So apologies to the Iggy fans in the house. I didn't know why. But regardless, I was going to try real hard, some of you are going to get this, to avoid black squirrel moments today. This is a joke from my old classes. The black squirrel moment was a moment of distraction, where I would go off some tangent, right? Iggy is an example of that. I think culturally. But anyway, so where does it originate? Maybe it originates from God. Maybe it originates from some outside thing. I think of this rhetorical concept. It's called an exigence, right? The exigence means this is a thing, on a topic on which you cannot remain silent, right? Think of all the arguments that you have with people whenever a topic comes up and you cannot not say anything, that is your exigence. This is the thing that you have to talk about, no matter what the situation. And I think that that also probably contributes to creation, right? This is a thing that we can't be quiet about, right? An exigence. So why are we driven to create? Is it that we want to see some change in the world? Is it that we want to contribute something to the culture? Is it something else? What do you think? Why do we do it?
Frustration.
That's a great answer.
Release
is a good one. Catharsis, right? Like there's some tumult in us and we've got to calm the seas, right? Yeah, I think I agree with those things. Because if you think about all of the people, and obviously like I'm an English person, a literature head, right? So most of my experience with this is with authors and we know from having studied so many of them that so many of them are tortured, right? Before the process, during the process, after the process, Virginia Woolf, one of my favorites, put rocks in her pockets and waded into the river, you know, and killed herself. Like, this is pretty, I mean, the suicide among artists is not an unusual thing. So they're obviously tortured people. So torture, frustration, all of these things are very good answers. And I don't know really where my creativity comes from. And I guess that's why I wanted to talk to you about it, trying to figure it out for myself, you know. And beyond that, do you think that there is, and we're just going to skip down the list a little bit here. Do you think that there is something, Because I think there is something selfish about a creative act.
We don't do it for other people. We do it for ourselves, and we hope that they like it.
That's it, right?
Even though we say, oh, I write for my fans, no, we write for
ourselves. We write for ourselves, yeah.
And then we hope that somebody
else. Yeah, and so in that way, sending something out into the world is a really tenuous thing, right? Because it's for me, and now I gave it to you, and you might hate it, right?
I hope not.
I hope not too, man. Hey, look, Amazon.com, come on now, let's get some reviews today. I'm a five star. I'm just kidding. Obviously, everyone's going to have a different reaction to everything, right? When I look at contemporary art, I'm like, that is definitely a toilet. That is an art, right? That's because I don't understand. But, you know, I look at a Rembrandt, and I'm like, that's beautiful. Like, certain things speak to different people, right? And so we have to understand that art isn't universal. Our appreciation of it can't be universal. Certain things speak to certain people, right? So, you know, the hope is that you create something that someone can enjoy other than yourself. But ultimately, yeah, it's for me, right? I had to get that story out. And so how do you get from that place where you have to get the story out just to get it out? And then to the place where you're like, ah, maybe some other people should read this, right? Maybe I'd want to give this to someone. But that's a tradition as old as language, right? Mm-hmm. Like the oral tradition, sitting around the campfire, telling people stories, handing out pamphlets because there were no publishers, right? Like you just wanted to share the art. You wanted to give a piece of yourself to the world. Do you think, and this is sort of shifting a little bit, do you think there are versions of creativity that are valued by our culture more than others?
Yes. Absolutely.
You say yes? And what are some of those? What is it, movies? Yeah, movies are valued more. Because we know that because Batman vs. Superman has a 31% fresh rating on Rotten Tomatoes. And it's still on target to have the fifth largest opening weekend in American history.
Yeah.
So, yeah, right. Also, I can't decide if I want to see it or not. I want to so bad, but I also don't want to. It'd be like a hate watch. What other kinds of creativity? And think about that beyond just the arts, right? Like creativity extends into all disciplines. I mean, think engineering, right? Somebody looked at that river and said, we need to find a way across that river. We have to build a bridge, right? Mm-hmm. Like, isn't that creative as well? And obviously that's necessary because we have to travel. We have to get those trucks to move, right? So we can get food in the grocery stores. So Allison can bring me a cake.
Yeah.
An entire red velvet cake.
Woo!
And that is incredibly important to my survival. So I'm very glad that the guy built the bridge, you know?
Absolutely.
So yeah, I think that there are versions of creativity that are more valuable, definitely. And I don't even know that it's wrongfully so, right? Some things we have to have, and some things are pleasure, right? Some things are a privilege. I think art is a privilege. So I ask you this, we'll skip to the bottom here. What is the value of literature, or the value of writing? Is there value in it? Do you find pleasure in it? Do you find value in it? What is that value? Anybody, Jane? What is the value of literature?
Oh, thank you so much.
You're welcome. This is what you get to do when you leave and come back.
The value of literature, I mean, I think it's the reflection of a society, of a person. I think it's extremely valuable that people can.
Some of the characters in here are really interesting to me. There's a girl, her name is Noma. She's a witch, maybe. hard to tell sometimes. But she walks through Alan's dreams. Alan is plagued by these terrible nightmares. And this girl, Noma, tries to help him figure out what they're all about. And so she physically, in some ways, maybe, puts herself into his dreams so that she can see what's happening, so that she can try to help him figure it out. And so that's an interesting sort of like surrealist kind of moment, right? Where you're trying to figure out, is she really in there, or is he just dreaming her in there, or whatever, right? So that's part of the magical part of it, all right? Now, where did it come from? I told Julie's class this morning. The first time I wrote the words, A Year Since the Rain, on a piece of paper, was in my journal, and I was sitting again at that Starbucks in Conyers. And I thought I was writing a poem. Because I published poetry, and I just kind of always thought that my creative outlet would be poetry. Because as a teacher, I don't have a lot of mental power to put on long pieces of work. I can draft a poem in a day and revise a poem and revise a poem and revise a poem forever, right? So I thought I was writing a poem about this girl that had left 1 year earlier, and it was raining on that day, right? So you sort of start to see the parallels, right? Between what would become the book and the poem that I was trying to write, A Year Since the Rain. So I wrote 6 pages of terrible, terrible poetry, which is usually how it works, right? You just write really, really bad poetry, really, really bad poetry, and then one day you decide that you're going to be a novelist, because poetry is harder than you thought it was going to be. I started writing poetry, and I have to say this because Julie got kicked out of it this morning. I started writing poetry when I was in middle school to holler at girls. They weren't even personalized poems, right? Like, it was just like love poems. I kept them in a green folder. I was at school one day, and I was like, she's looking good. I like flipped through, found one that looked kind of appropriate, pass it off to her, and like, get a load of that, honey. Get at me. And, and it worked, some. So I started writing this poem, A Year Since the Rain. It didn't work. 6 pages later, I decided, this is not working. Fold up the journal, put it on the shelf. We'll try again later, maybe. A year later, again, so now we're 2 years since the rain in real life, I sat down at that Starbucks again, and I wrote this line. That is the first line of the book. Last summer, when the rivers dried up, I was living next door to a witch. Now, you can ask me, a million times where that line came from, and I have not got an answer for you. I have no idea where that line came from. And that goes to your point. Maybe inspiration is God. Maybe inspiration is something from out there. Because I don't know where that line came from. I didn't know anything about witches or whatever, right? Like, it just sounded kind of catchy. It's like it had a nice flow to it. I was like, let's do that. That sounds good. Feels good, right? And so I wrote that line, and then I kept writing. And I started to develop this little town. And in that town, on this little street anyway, there was this guy, Alan. There was this woman next door who was a witch. She didn't have a name yet. Across the street, there was a couple. They were having marital problems. The protagonist really liked the wife that lived across the street. She had really long legs, wore short dresses, you know. He's into that. Leg guy, Alan. there's a lot of other stuff. You know, the married couple, they had this terrible dog that barks really early in the morning and wakes Alan up during his hangovers and stuff like that. So, you know, it's like mainstream America, right? Like, that could be Covington. Maybe it is a little bit. But, you know, it could be any small town. And so I kept writing, and I thought, okay, this is a short story. All right, how long is a short story, you people that teach short stories?
6,000
words. What's the top end of that? 6,000 words, something like that? So I thought at 2,000, I was like, I'm writing a short story. Then at 6,000, I was like, I don't think this is short anymore, right? This is starting to feel pretty long. Maybe it's a novella. And it just kept going. At some point, I sort of came to terms with the fact that the story I was writing was bigger than what I had anticipated, right? It was bigger than a line of poetry. It was bigger than a short story. The world I created had to have room to breathe, and these characters had to have room to live, and so I had to open up the world for them and let them go. And I mentioned this earlier. I mentioned this morning, too. But I think it bears repeating. George R.R. Martin, who you know as the guy who writes Game of Thrones, that is not written by HBO, by the way. That is written by George R.R. Martin, who is still alive, even though George Martin, the producer of The Beatles, died. And everyone on Twitter was like, George R.R. Martin died, and he didn't finish the books. Right, I know. So George R.R. Martin said that there are two kinds of writers in the world. The first type is the architect. All right? An architect has to know every movement of the story before he starts to write. You have to outline, very detailed outlines, right? The second type is the planter or the farmer. You plant the seeds of the story, and then you let the story happen to you, right? And I believe probably most writers are some combination of both of those things, right? I know for me, I was probably 30,000 words into that book before I ever put an outline together to try to figure out how to resolve it. I just let it happen. And I would talk to people on the phone, and I would say, you're never going to believe what Alan got into today. Like, he's some guy that I know, just out having shenanigans, you know? I'm like, Alan and his buddy Jeff, they were driving around mixing whiskey in some 62-ounce plastic cups they got at the gas station. And they were, but not in real life, right? So that's the evolution. How did it find life? Just real briefly, and I know that I've been talking for a long time, and I'm real sorry about that. But it found life with an independent publisher, and I realized that independent publishers are smaller than the big traditional houses. They're willing to take chances on some weird books. I pitched to a lot of agents that essentially said, your book is really well written, it's pretty, I just don't know how to market it, right? I don't know how to sell it to a big box publisher because it's not young adult, it's not dystopian, it's not romance, it's not, you know, it doesn't fit neatly into any of those big genres. It's general fiction, and general fiction is a tough act to sell. especially when it's kind of weird. So I'll read just a little bit of it, and I'll get out of your hair. Again, thank you so much, and I hope those of you who do know me, and even if you don't, I hope that you stick around a little bit afterward and shake my hand. It's really, really cool to see you guys. We'll start just in the first chapter. I'll read just a little bit of it. If you get a copy later, you'll notice that I'm cleaning it up a little bit. I'm trying anyway. Last summer when the rivers dried up, I was living next door to a witch. I still don't really know if she was a legitimate witch or what a legitimate witch even is, but I do know that when she told the people in the neighborhood, mostly the kids, that she was a witch, she meant in every magical sense in which she could be. Before the drought and after a good rain, I would see her out in the big field behind the houses collecting frogs, and all I could think was, are you serious? Frogs. She's got to be messing with us, right? And for the most part, she kept to herself, and I kept to myself, and everyone else kept to themselves, all tucked into their little suburban houses. I'm afraid you're going to have a hard time with this. I know I've had a very hard time with it, dealing with it, believing it, living it. Just over a year ago, when the skies first dried up, you had just moved off for work. I remember being pissed at your job when they wanted to relocate. But it's only a year, you said. And I knew that. I knew what 365 days looked like on paper, which didn't make me feel better. It takes several seconds to flip through a calendar, and every one of those little blank squares represents 1 million things that could change. A relationship with more mileage could have been different, maybe, but we were young. Not as in I was young and you were young, but the collective we was young. The timeline between seeing you and meeting you for the first time and the moment that you disappeared was not a long one. I approached you at a little bar up the street. I was the outsider trying to blend in, who had moved here for work for a computer programming company a decade earlier. You were in marketing and brand management. You kissed me that night, and I jerked my head back a little because I wasn't used to girls that A, kissed on the first date, even though it wasn't a date, but a chance meeting, and B, made first moves. I decided I liked it, though, and started kissing you almost every day. Love moved fast in those days of steady rain, and even though I'm not usually one for change, for some reason I embraced it with you. Maybe it was my willingness to give it a go with you that has made this last year so hard, or maybe it's just this pesky, incessant drought, but it was anything but dry in those days. The trees were always green as they should have been, and the asshole across the street, the guy with the loud-ass dog that barked at everything, was always cutting his grass. You guys have all had that neighbor, right? Mm-hmm. Even if you live in an apartment, it's like somebody just running around upstairs, like, get your kid under control. What? And it's 8 o'clock in the morning. Although, I mean, this is probably going to say more about me than any of you. Like, he gets mad at you because the guy's cutting grass at 10 in the morning. I'm just still trying to get my sleep on, you know? I should probably also say that Alan is not me. It seems like a good time. I would like to point out that my parents are both right over here. These are the charming folks here on the front row of the second section. You guys don't have to call, right? They didn't do anything. This is mostly an accident. They did an excellent job with me, I hope. I point them out because Alan has a slightly different home situation at this point in his life, and I wanted to prove to you that I'm not him. We'll get into this section. I'm sorry?
Been married 51 years.
51 years, that's also an important number, but hey, you can't clap for that. 51 years is a long time. I met you on a Thursday night full of smoke and bourbon and kissing. The rain fell outside, which drove everyone into the arms of strangers. You could almost bet on getting late if it was raining, which was good news in those days. I'm not a psychologist or anything, but I spent a lot of time thinking about what it was that made that happen in the rain. I always attributed it to some subconscious connection that the culture had made with Purple Rain, the song. Whatever it was, everyone was in on it, and everyone got loose. Jeff, the guy I always went to the bars with, my wingman, I guess, always said, when the bottom falls out, the bottoms fall off. This was usually screamed over the music from the local band on the tiny stage in the corner of our favorite bar right before we did a shot of Jägermeister. Jeff was a pig, but he made me laugh, and he looked out for me. It should be noted that Jeff is not a literal pig. This is not a Pixar. You were different, though. You were not one of the girls in town that looked for excuses to crawl into bed with a stranger. You had some walls, and maybe I liked that we had that in common. That night, you kissed me a lot, but you wouldn't let me get too comfortable or greedy. a tug at the belt that hugged your slender waist as the night was winding down. Your back pressed into your front door and my chest pressed into yours. Your hand pushed mine away and you whispered, "Not tonight." And I thought I would go crazy. You slipped the business card in my pocket, kissed my cheek, and said goodnight so close to my ear that my entire right side went numb. You didn't ask me to wait much longer past that first night. Dinner and a movie later, we were back at my place throwing that belt across the room. 2 weeks later, my father died. We were asleep when the phone rang. We had fallen asleep to the sound of the rain hitting the window pane over the bed, and when the phone pulled me out of that sleep, I noticed the rain was still falling hard. Still groggy, I picked up the phone. On the other end of the line, my mom, through quiet whimpers, told me that the heart attack had come on quickly. They couldn't get him anywhere fast enough. He died waiting on the ambulance. I put the receiver down and you asked if I was all right. I just asked you for a glass of water and you said, "Sure, babe," and disappeared into the hallway. When you had gone, I moved to the bathroom, bending over the toilet. In the rippling water, I could see him collapse in his chair. I hoped he got to die in that chair. He was grasping at his arm and his chest and my mother. His eyes, the helpless eyes of a deer in a bear trap, watching the dark window for the reflection of red lights that would never come. I saw him pull my mother down to him in his final moments, his hands shaking, his chest aching. I imagined that they embraced until the end, as they must have known that it would be it, the final moments of a 40-year marriage. I can't even imagine what I must have looked like when you came back in from the kitchen holding a glass of tap water. I remember looking down into the toilet afraid I would vomit, but all I could do was cry. And all I could keep telling myself was, "This isn't what Dad would want. Stop crying." I looked up at you standing in the door. You had just put the glass down on the counter. You stepped toward me with a hand out tentatively. You touched me, and I turned into you and let you hold me as I kept crying and crying. I was so far away, and he was just so dead. No one ever really knows how they will respond to a parent's death. Shit. No one knows how they will respond to anything. But I sure as hell didn't think I would crumble like that. That I would need someone to hold me while I wanted to vomit, but could only cry. You see, we went through a lot of shit together. I don't care how long a relationship has gone on or how much mileage it has on the tires. No one is ever ready to hold their lover in the bathroom while he cries over his dead father. But you did it. You held me, and I would have held you if your father had died. It was 2 weeks in, and even though we were both scared shitless of it, we loved each other. So when I look at this story, I look at Alan, and I say, this guy's a sad sack. I say that every single time I introduce the story. Because he writes this whole book to this girl, right? He knew her for 2 weeks, and then she was gone. Like, what about her gets in him, and he can't let go of her, right? And I think that is a few things. First of all, and I'm not going to spoil it too much for you, I don't think this book is really about her at all. I think he's dealing with other stuff, and she just catches it. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. The second thing, and I think this is really important, is that moment. You've been in a relationship before where something emotionally traumatic happened, external to the relationship, and it pushed you together to that person in a way that you hadn't been pushed together before, right? 2 weeks in, she held him after his father died, right? And he fell apart. There's something to that. Their relationship took on a new weight after that, right? There's no way it couldn't. And so to him, she becomes much more important as a result of that. I've asked this question to some of the people that have read the book, and I've asked, is it even fair to put that much on a person, right, that you've only known for 2 weeks? Any of us, if we're decent people, would have held him when he was crying because his dad died. But if we were romantically involved with the person we were holding, we have to assume that it's going to take on a new weight, a new heaviness, right? Mm-hmm. I don't want to go into too much more here. I know I've held you for a long time. Do you feel okay? Everybody doing all right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, staying with me? Mm-hmm. All right, nobody's sleeping. Maybe one person's sleeping, but that's okay. let's see. Do you want to hear about the dreams or do you want to hear about the witch?
Dreams.
Interesting. I heard a witch. Did I hear a witch?
Yeah.
Cool. Okay. Maybe we'll go a twofer here. We'll do a two for one. But we won't stay long. These aren't long sections. All right. So this is Alan sort of lays out of work for a while. Then he goes out with his buddy Jeff, and they do flaming shots, as you do after you break up with someone. It's a rite of passage and all of that, right? And then Alan goes back to work, fine. Goes back to work, tries to get his normal life back. He's going to the mailbox at this point when he runs into the witch, has his first real conversation with her. I turned the ball back up the driveway toward my own door, but as my body swiveled, I saw her, the witch. She was at her mailbox, pulling a small package out of the very back. She was even closer than she had been the night before. The night before, there's this really creepy scene where she watches him through the window. I won't talk too much about that, though. Creeper. That was not in here. I'm sorry, I just said that. That's confusing. I didn't move. I had never been this close to her. I was frozen. The local lore of her mystery captivated me, and I was honestly a little bit scared of her. "Why were you outside lying on your porch for so long last night?" she asked. Her voice was surprisingly young, not the old crackling of a needle on vinyl that you expect when you hear the word witch. Mm-hmm. She didn't even look at me. I was drawn by her reply. I felt something come over me. There was an air about her that made me want to open up to her, to tell her everything. I fought it, whatever it was, back down inside. I was locked out. I was drawn toward her in the strangest way. I took a few steps toward her. She didn't turn to look at me. She exhaled slowly and looked up into the night sky as the final rays of the day were retreating. "There's a sadness inside of you," she said. "You know that, don't you? I feel it. Through the walls, in the air, it shows on your skin, especially in the dry air. I felt it through the window last night when you looked into my eyes for a very long time from the porch." She paused and breathed in deep once more. "She hurt you, didn't she? The girl that was coming here for a while? I haven't seen her lately. Why?" "Her job. It sent her away." The whole moment was entirely surreal. The sun's retreat cast a deep purple glow to the early evening sky, and some insect nearby was making a sound in the thin, dry air. But most surreal of all was that the witch was talking to me. She still hadn't looked at me, though. She just stood there, profiled to me, looking at the label on the package she had just retrieved from the mail. She wore a loose-fitting gown, dark, gray, and long. And her hair, was it brown? Was it gray? The light made it hard to see her plainly, which was frustrating. Here I was face to face with the witch, and I couldn't even see her enough for description. Her mystery was possibly her own creation, but she sold that shit hard. "You loved her," she said, "I guess. But how do you know? It hurts very much now that she's gone." I still felt it, the need to talk to her, to volunteer information that I wasn't capable of sharing with others that I had known much longer. "It's not always love that hurts when it's gone," she paused. And then we'll get just a little bit of the dream action, and then we'll call it a day. I just went through this book a while ago and put marks in it so I could find all these sections. And I'm super prepared, obviously. Like, I knew this was happening 3 weeks ago, and I just did it today. Let's see. Let's make sure that this one has a bunch of them in it. Yeah, I just want to get into... In the dream, it was raining like a bad cliche, but that was an invention of my subconscious. His dreams, there are two of them that recur. The first dream, he's at his father's funeral, and it starts to rain really bad. And it rains so much that it fills in the grave, it lifts the casket, and takes it away from him. Mm. And then he drowns. That's the first dream that recurs over and over again. The second dream, he falls into the earth, and he's in this really dark, really open cave. And in the distance, he sees three figures, three women, at a spinning wheel. Mm-hmm. And he tries to get to them, can never really get there. So these are the two dreams that Nauman tries to help him navigate and try to figure out, right? If you know anything about Greek mythology, the three women in the cave with the spinning wheel, that's a reference, those are the three fates. And some of the characters here are representative of those three fates. I'm sorry. Anyway, in the dream it was raining like a bad cliche, but that was an invention of my subconscious. Mom had never mentioned how the weather had been on the day of my father's funeral in any of her phone calls or cards. Alan didn't go to his own father's funeral. Probably worth noting. Mm. Under the green tent, Mom was next to me, and she was crying and crying, but not out loud, like would have been maybe justifiable. She was crying the way people do sometimes, like she was having a hard time swallowing a thick liquid. She was choking her sobbing and trying her best to hold it back. At the front of the small group, there was a woman speaking that I didn't recognize. I could hear her, but I couldn't understand her voice. It was a muffled sound, not quite like the sounds made by the adults that talked to Charlie Brown when I was a kid, but it was similar in a way to that disembodied womp-womp that greeted the questions that he and Linus and Lucy would raise in class. You squeezed my hand tight, and when I looked at you, I noticed that you seemed to be disappearing. My hand, the hand you had just squeezed, seemed lighter. When I looked down, I saw your hand dissolve into the air like a mist, and the rest of you followed close behind. Your face drew close to mine, and as you were about to kiss my cheek, you turned to clouds and blew away in the wind. I looked for what seemed like a long time at your chair. Of course, in the way that dreams manipulate our perceptions of time, I probably only looked at your dream chair for a few seconds. Regardless of all that dream time I spent looking at your chair trying to fathom how someone could just disappear, the woman at the front of the ceremony was still speaking, and I just couldn't hear her. I didn't hear anything that she said until she called my name, Alan. As I stood to move toward the front of the rickety funeral tent, the rain began to fall even harder, and the wind blew hard, causing the flaps at the top of the gray tent to slap against each other. The rain fell and fell and fell so hard that the grave that had been dug for my father was soon filled. The water rose so fast that the flood took me and all of the people at the funeral by surprise. The woman at the front of the tent had called my name. I assumed I was moving to the front to give a eulogy or do some other genre of funeral speaking. But all at once, I was swimming against a current in water so high, I thought it very possible I may drown. I was always only a fair swimmer. Also not me. I'm a terrible swimmer. The rain kept falling from the sky, and the water kept rising from the ground until my father's casket was lifted up and swept downstream. I tried swimming after it for a long time, but I couldn't catch up to it. I just couldn't reach it. He just kept floating farther and faster away from me until he disappeared over the horizon into some other place. And when I finally stopped swimming and looked around, I realized I had gone so far that I was lost. I wasn't in the cemetery anymore. I couldn't see my mother or the strange lady whose voice I didn't know. I couldn't see you, but you were everywhere. You were always there in the water. You were the water, and the water was you. And that's why it wasn't fair that I woke up to a world in a drought. But when in the dream I dipped my head beneath the water, I woke up into a world of only air. And I'll pause there, or stop there even. Thanks for bearing with me during that. I'll bring Julie back up. I guess we'll do a couple of questions or something, if anybody has any. What time is it? I didn't look. It might be time for you. Yeah, we got a couple minutes. Anybody got any questions? Let's talk about it. Yeah, what's up?
Think about voice.
Yeah.
How did you decide that he's telling the story? I mean, how do you know? Yeah. But when you decided to talk, determine how you're going to write this book, mm-hmm. why did you say Alan's going to be
the character? Right. Like, why instead of a third person?
Right. When you look at when you're writing, how do you determine the voice that you're going to do?
It's a really good question, and I'm not even sure that I have a great answer for it. Because I'm working on a new book, and it's definitely in third person, you know?
Was it easier to do in third person than
first person? I think on some level, because it's written in second person, right? Like, I mean, he's telling his own story, but he's also writing to a person.
Yeah,
right?
He's writing to a person.
Right. So it is first person in that he's telling us the things that happened to him.
Right.
But it's still like this letter that he's writing to this reader person, right? Whoever
but
she
it's through his eyes.
It's through his eyes, yeah. And I think that for this, because I wanted there to be this air of mystery and this air of like surrealism, and I wanted to experience the world through him, because to me Alan's a skeptic, right? And in a world that's sort of run by magical realism, right? And there's all this weird magic stuff going on in there. I think it's interesting to ground it in the head of a skeptic, right? Someone who's always like, is this really happening? Is this really happening? Whereas a third person narrator would be more willing to accept it, right? And so I think that it loses some of the gray, right? Some of the in-between. I like the ambiguity. I think Alan gives us a little bit of ambiguity that a third person maybe would. Does that make sense?
Yes. Yeah.
Cool. Other questions?
Tell me something you noticed when he was reading.
First word.
Sorry, first word.
Okay. Have you ever read a book from school that had them in there?
Not that what?
Not so far, or
like not that strong word.
Oh wow!
So let me ask you this: do you think that we watch movies all the time that have those kinds of words in them, right? And typically, you have certain characters that would use that kind of language, right? And then you have other characters that would not use that kind of language. And so you learn something about a guy based on his vocabulary, right? And I think that standing here in front of you, like you can probably tell that those words feel pretty natural in my mouth. But at the same time, like I don't just go around just dropping F-bombs on people, right? So not that Alan dropped any on us so far. But regardless, like I think that the way that people talk sort of dictates how we view them, right? And one of the interesting things about the book is that he starts off with this really sort of abrasive language, right? And as he moves, as he evolves as a character, the language softens as he develops. And so like I said, like I was a planter when I was writing the beginning of the book, right? So I just kind of threw the seeds in there and let it happen. But I have to assume that that's because at the beginning of the book, Alan's in a really dark and really sort of tumultuous place, right? And so he's frustrated and there's this chaos in his brain, so he's just kind of like angry. And then as he sort of works through all his problems, he, you know, like there are sections in the book, long expansive sections, that there are no curse words at all. Like near the end, especially once he sort of comes around, like it's about self-actualization, right? Like he feels less angry, and so he loses some of that language. Yeah.
So like when he used that kind of vulgar language, like the people that are reading the book could actually probably relate to him because they probably feel what he feels.
Yeah, right. You know, there's this song, and I know that all of you have heard this song. It's Little Lion Man by Mumford & Sons. It uses the F word in that song. And I think that he says, it was not your fault but mine. It was your heart on the line. I really effed it up this time, didn't I, my dear, right? And I think, like, when you're talking about that, like, there's sometimes where we mess up, right? There's sometimes where we screw up. And then there's sometimes where we just all up, you know what I mean? And all just falls apart. And like, that's a varying level of screwing up, you know what I mean? And this is the top C, the number one C, the UNC of screwing up, you know? And so, yeah, you're right. Like sometimes a situation is just shitty and there's no other word for it other than that, you know what I mean? So yeah, I think you're right. I think that maybe a reader could relate to Alan in his frustration.
Do you think that as in general, that the more we gain perspective and the more we have insight into what is causing this angst, the better able we are to verbalize it? So in the beginning, the curse words are basically...
Because it doesn't know how to fill in the gaps, right? They're placeholders, right? Mm-hmm. And I think that's what they normally are.
Yeah.
I don't think that the curse words have any real power. I think they're very descriptive, and I think they're necessary sometimes, but I don't think that there's a lot of power in the curse words. What I do think it does is I think it holds a place, right, for when you don't really know what else to say, right? And yeah, I think you're right. I think that he gets better as he goes. As he learns more about himself and his world, he gets much better at articulating. I think we all do, right?
I think there's a lot of power.
I was
going to say.
Yeah.
I think I'll clarify
it with this. To me, curse words don't carry much power, but I definitely think that they can carry power, depending on the listener and the context. Does that make sense?
Right. And if you don't use it a lot, and then you use one, you know that person is definitely
upset
something.
Or something. No, I can agree with that.
So it has more power when used judiciously.
Yeah, yes. I can agree with that, definitely. And I do think it has a lot to do with context.
Yeah, definitely.
Shane, can you talk about your next work?
Oh, God. Oh, man, okay. that's tough, but I definitely can. I'm going to back this up here so everybody can sort of see what's doing. So the next work is tentatively called No Sitting in the Mosh Pit. It's about a rock band. It's also got some little magical elements to it. There's a girl there. The next book is really about the different parts of the artistic endeavor, right? And so I'm engaging in these questions about creativity in the next novel. And so the next novel sort of takes the creative endeavor in three different phases. It is inspiration, creation, and legacy. And so it's really about like what an artist goes through in those initial stages. Like what does it take in order to make him create? What does the actual creative process look like? And then what is the end game, right? Like does he want, what does legacy look like for that person, right? And so the novel sort of takes several different avenues to look at that. There are different artists and musicians in the novel that sort of gain various levels of fame, fortune, and things like that. And so it asks questions about whether or not fame is really legacy, or there are other ways to leave that behind.
Is it the same town, world?
No. This one is more metropolitan vibe than Foster. This book is set definitely in a small town.
Noma.
Noma. Yeah.
Would you spell that?
Yeah. Noma. So, Alan, I was looking for like an everyman sort of name, like he could be anybody, right? And Alan felt like, I didn't want to go Joe or Bob or anything like that. Alan just sort of felt right for just kind of a guy.
Is it A-L-E-A-N?
A-L-A-N. Yeah. And then with Jeff, Jeff is the wingman of the group, right? Like, so he's the guy that always takes Alan out to the bars and everything. And Jeff was a guy that I knew at a bar. Like, I pulled the name from the guy. Yeah. His name is Jeff, and Jeff in the book is every guy that I've ever been to a bar with. You know, like every wingman ever, all of their characteristics are all just sort of piled in on Jeff. People always ask me too, like, am I going to see myself in your book? Are you going to get me in trouble with my wife? And I'm not. They're all sort of thrown in there together. Now, in terms of the other characters, there's Nona, Desi, and Sam. These are the three women who represent the Fates, and all of those names are derivative of the names of the Fates. And then there's another character who never really gets a name. It's the woman who lives across the street that wears the short dresses and has the long legs. He only ever calls her legs. And she's sort of a siren, right? And so always just an object to him. He acknowledges before he finishes with her, he says, I definitely know her name, so don't judge me about this. That's how she came into my life, and that's how she goes out.
She has a husband.
Right.
He gets a name?
Maybe. I don't remember. Isn't that interesting? If he does, it's only for a minute. He's just mostly the asshole across the street. That cuts his grass every Saturday morning. Yeah.
Why do you not rather than say self-publish?
Yeah, I thought about self-publishing, and I talked about this a little bit this morning too. I think that it's a disease related to my life in academia, if I can be honest. Because I thought about self-publishing because, you know, it's not so much about selling a bunch of books. Like, I just want people to read it, you know what I mean? But with self-publishing, I know that it's tougher to get an audience. A traditional publishing house has a little bit more muscle behind it, you know? Obviously not, with an indie, not as much as the big guys, right? But they have a little bit of muscle. They can help me push it a little bit. They have some different channels that they can help push it through.
I think like cover art and
what I mean. Yeah, right, yeah, that was it. I mean, yeah, so the cover art, they have an in-house graphic designer and things like that. They just make it a lot easier in a lot of ways. Because when you self-publish, you have to outsource a lot of that stuff, you know? Or do it yourself. And I can never do that. You know, like, that looks pretty good. I'm into it.
And you said there were several editors, and that was
helpful. And I did go through several edits with the publisher. Like, again, that's something if I'm going to get. And I know you self-published this book, right?
Yep.
No Safe Harbor. It's about piracy.
It's a nonfiction political essays.
So okay, nonfiction political essays. Do they have any of these out? Yeah. Do you have some with yourself?
Yeah, free to download.
Free to download. There you go. What's your name? Mm-hmm. Come on. What is it?
Andrew.
Look up Andrew. Get with Andrew. I've read some of it, like some of the stuff that he does online. It's very good. This is Misty's husband, right? Very cool. Yeah.
Do you find, talking about the editing process, is it hard as the creator of an art to let that go and to not take editing personally?
Yeah, it can be.
Let me ask that to the students. How many of you have ever written something and thought it was really good, and why didn't you have to? And then it gets torn up by the editor known as, don't point at any of my professors. have you ever had that experience?
Yeah. Oh, okay. I've had that experience.
Yeah, I have too.
And I give that experience several times a day. So this is the way it goes. I finished the draft. It took me like a year to write one draft. And then I spent the next few months revising it myself. Then, this was the hardest thing. Like, giving it to the editors at the publisher was whatever. But I let my girlfriend read it. That's tough. Because she's also a copy editor, right? So she's got hawk eyes, you know? And she went through it and marked it up in a big way. Like, don't let anybody tell you, don't let your significant other read your book because they're going to go too soft on you. Because she brought out the claws, man. But I was better for it, right? She's also, you know, she was gentle enough, right? Like, she tried. But I'll tell you, this version of the book has 100% more porta potties in it because she read it. And that'll make more sense to you as you read it. They gotta, you know, do all that somewhere. So that was the hardest part of it, was having somebody that close to me really dig into it, right? But the book was better for that. Then, once it got picked up, the editor with the publisher went through and made his suggestions, right? Now, what my girlfriend did was mostly line edits, and then just a couple of little suggestions. He was looking at developmental stuff, right? Plot goals, character development, consistencies, right? Across different chapters and things like that. He also, at one point, asked me to lose the second person. Because he thought it was complicating things. And I didn't want to do that. So So he was willing. This is, I think, another benefit of the smaller house. I think a big publisher would strong-arm me into doing what they wanted me to do, and he actually had a conversation with me, and we figured out a way to save it. So, because that second person was really important, right? Like you were talking about the voice of the character. Like, I wanted to preserve that. That was one of the things that I thought was really important.
Is one long letter or a series of letters?
Yeah, so there's a preface at the top in the front of the book that is, what you learn in the preface is that this is a collection of essentially like journal entries that they find in the wreckage of this town. And so this is an effort by a local-ish university to preserve, like to collect all the records from this town's demolition, essentially, right? And so they've organized all of these texts that they found together in an envelope. It includes Alan's journals, newspaper clippings, and other little letters and things like that they've also compiled together. And so it's framed up on either side by this note from the archivist at the university that tells you sort of like, this is what was happening, this is where we found it, all that stuff. Yeah.
Do you like your characters?
Some of them. I think I go back and forth on Alan. I think Alan's really funny because he's sarcastic like me, and I think he's funny. But also I think he's just really kind of pathetic sometimes. So I get upset with him because he doesn't want to do anything. Like, you know, he's so stagnant sometimes. Like, but I mean, he has to come to that, and he does. He's sort of, he's definitely a dynamic character that changes. I like him much more at the end than I do at the beginning, even though I think he's funnier at the beginning because he's so angry, right? It's like a Lewis Black kind of guy at the time, right? Real bitter about the world. But he, you know, he softens up, and I think that he's a better person at the end. I like him more. I did get real attached to some of those characters, man, and when they leave, for whatever reason, I did get a little sad when I'm leaving, but that's just me, you know. They're in me, right? Those characters are a part of me, so I hope that some of you like them too. Anything else? I think we need to probably start to wrap it up. It's about 4, maybe some people that happen. Yeah?
Is there a lot that you do, or is there any of it that you would change now since it's been published and you've reread it and go, why didn't I think about
this then,
or maybe this
would
work better?
Nothing really pops out immediately, I mean, because, you know, at some point you have to sort of accept that the story is the story, and now we're just trying to clean things up. I think you could second guess yourself into an early grave over stuff like that, you know what I mean? But I think I read the final proof before the version, you know. I was telling somebody earlier today, I got that book in my hand about a week and a half before it actually released. I was going through the proof and doing my final line edits essentially 2.5-3 weeks before it came out. It was already on pre-order whenever I was doing those final edits. So it was tight. And so I read it cover to cover in a day doing edits. And when I got to the end of it, I was like, it feels complete. You know, I don't feel like there's anything missing. There were definitely moments when I did feel like there were things missing, but I got those in there. You know? But yeah, I don't think that would change anything.
We
want to
thank Shane Wilson for being here.
You guys, hey, for real though.
We have the bookstore here right outside in this little alcove. Those of you who wish to go ahead and purchase the book, I think Shane will sign it for you.
100%. I'm going to hang out here. Please shake my hand before you go. And those of you that are here and you actually kind of like me, stick around.